Actually, I have to start with previous discussions. I was here somewhere. Let me share that. So, dear students, good morning and welcome to the class of VLSI System Design Theory course. We were discussing non-ideal effects, basically those effects which are coming due to channel length scaling or width scaling. So, narrow channel effects and narrow width channel is there, or narrow width is there, then also some effects are there that also will be discussed. So, short channel you are making, channel length you are decreasing, that is also affecting. And if you are changing width also, going down, then it is affecting. So, so many effects are on threshold voltage also. So, as already we have discussed previously here, drain induced by real lowering, I have explained that if you are increasing the drain voltage, then it is basically also contributing some, means whatever calculation we have done in threshold voltage calculation, during that we have considered all the depletion region is, or depletion region charges are created only by the applied gate voltage. But if you are increasing drain voltage, so barrier threshold voltage calculation formula will not be valid, because drain voltage is also contributing some depletion, means channel is depleted due to drain voltage also. So source side, drain side also, we have seen that there is diagram here, means depletion is depletion region charges are contributed by drain voltage also, and here some source side also depleting, and gate voltage is contributing. So this is why some at smaller dimension, when channel length is decreased, as here we can see, threshold voltage is very much very fast decreasing, roll off, it is called rolling off. So VT0 is the threshold voltage without any body bias. So here we are showing without any body bias. Obviously body bias you are applying, then threshold voltage will increase. So that we have already idea. So drain induced barrier lowering is basically the means phenomena that threshold voltage decreases with the drain bias. If you are at lower technology, means at advanced technology node, means at lower channel length dimension, means smaller channel length, shorter channel length. But if you are above one micron, means long channel device, then these are not pronounced, but for shorter channel length it is very much effective. So drain induced barrier lowering is also required to consider. Let me take a pointer. So DIBL, or drain induced barrier lowering, which is basically it is caused by VDS, because VDS also creates some depletion region charges, and this decreases the threshold voltage, and the required charge which is created by the gate voltage is less. Whatever we are calculating previously, that is only we are considering only gate contribution, but some portion channel is depleted by drain voltage also. So this is why it is basically in short channel effect, short channel devices, it is to be considered. Drain induced barrier lowering means threshold voltage decreases with drain voltage, it is called drain induced barrier lowering. And this the cause already explained, that cause is the depletion region around the drain. This depletion region around the drain, it is basically causing the drain induced barrier lowering. So depletion region depth around the drain depends on the drain voltage. As VDS increases, depletion region gets deeper, and it extends towards the channel or towards the source. And for very large VDS, source and drain depletion region even can touch, meet each other, and this will also cause punch through. So this is also problem, and this results in the problem, means of the operation of this device. So this threshold voltage variation is basically roll off, rolling off from the diagram we have seen, and roll off of the threshold voltage is coming due to this various effects. And DIBL means drain induced barrier lowering, barrier is lowered and less threshold voltage will be required. Hart Carrier effect means threshold voltage drift or changes over the time, time as electron tunnels into oxide. Some electrons can tunnel if there is a very high field, then tunneling is also possible. So because of lower dimensions, if you are applying the same voltage, the electric field will be, more electric field will be generated. So if E equal to whatever applied voltage divided by V by D, so voltage you are keeping same, so dimension between source and drain gap is less, means the channel dimension less, so more field will be generated at the same voltage. Even you are applying the same voltage, still you are getting more field. So all the carriers, who are facing this field, they are called Hart carriers. Hart carriers means those who are transporting the, means basically those who are contributing in the charge transport, they are basically facing very high field. So if charges are transporting in very high field, then they are called Hart carriers. Either it is hole or electron, both are called Hart carrier, means very high field is there inside the channel. So Hart carrier effect is basically it is coming due to increased field, which causes electron velocity increases very fast, and high energy electrons are there. They can tunnel through gate oxide. Initially, gate oxide was a perfect, we are considering perfect, but sometimes it is thin also due to scaling. So it is more possibility of tunneling, and this changes the threshold voltage. And long channel devices, this problem is not there. So that is different. So that is different treatment. But for short channel, it is treatment different. So this high velocity of the electrons can impact in drain and hole dislodging also. And they sweep towards negatively charged substrate, and they cause substrate current, some impact ionization, and this impact ionization will break down. So this is another problem, that breakdown of the device is possible. At high voltage, it will be breaking down. So we can see long channel characteristics and short channel characteristics. We can see in this linear region also, triode region also, it is not exactly linear. Initially it is exactly linear, after that it is some shape is there, uniformity is there, but here we can see in the short channel device exactly linear. After that pinch off, after that channel length modulation is also appearing. It is increasing even in saturation region, it is increasing with some with drain voltage with some amount. So these are the differences which can be seen. Though in both the cases, in the short channel and long channel, W by L ratio, width by length ratio is same, but still in short channel devices, this type of characteristics we can see. Here in long channel devices, it is the characteristics. This dotted line is showing wherever pinch off point. This is pinch off point here, pinch off point here also. And here also after pinch off, it is getting saturation region, but in this saturation region also some channel length modulation is present. So even long channel, it is shown in small portion, but if you go longer, it will be almost linear. So these are the differences. And also I have not talked about this leakage current. I have already talked in leakage current. So that is sub-threshold current means this is the log of IDS versus VGS plot. So in log of IDS versus VGS plot, below the threshold, you can see some current is observed, though the amount is not shown exactly, but it is there. So that is basically sub-threshold current, and this is given by some equation, constant value, then these are constant values, then E raised power kV by kT, then also it depends on gate to source voltage and drain to source voltage. But previously I have seen that, I have explained that this is simplified one. We have simplified it. So if drain voltage is large, in that case drain voltage contribution we have simplified, and only the VGS minus VT term is coming. Also eta KT is coming, that we have explained. So eta is a KT by Q. This is the thermal voltage, 0.026 volt. So this is just another part. Sub-threshold current is also there. It is basically at below the threshold voltage, what is the current that we are considering zero, but in long channel devices it was okay, but in short channel devices we cannot consider zero. Some current is there, leakage current is called, and it should be considered. And also let us see some gate leakage current. It is also called Fowler Nordheim tunneling. So it is tunneling, it is coming due to tunneling. So if oxide thickness is not so large, it is in short channel devices generally channel is also not so large, thickness is not large, so leakage is possible. If short some thickness of the oxide is very small, in that case the leakage current due to tunneling. So it is also given by the name of the scientist, that Fowler Nordheim tunneling. So this current is given by IFN, because the name of FN, FNN is taken from here. So IFN, leakage current, gate leakage current due to tunneling, C1WLEOX whole square e^-E0/EOX. And E0 and C1 are constant. EOX is vertical field. Vertical field due to the gate voltage which you are applying. So electric field across the oxide vertically. And this is a proportional, this current is proportional to the area of the gate. Also this limits the scaling of the oxide, because if the oxide is very thin, then this current will be there. If oxide is not thin, then this current will not be there. So this is the requirement, that this type of gate leakage is gate leakage current will be possible if oxide thickness is very large, very small. So oxide thickness is very small, narrow oxide thickness. In that case, it is present. If it is large, then this possibility of tunneling is not there. So these are the few things. And effect of gate leakage, that it wastes some power, and leakage power raises the temperature of the chip also, and can cause functionality problems, and reducing the we should reduce this leakage. So long channel devices, small drain voltage, how to reduce, these are the processes. Long channel either you make, and also small drain voltage should be applied, and large threshold voltage is there, then it's possible. And narrow width effects, some narrow width effects that we can see. If you are narrowing the width, you are decreasing the width, so it increases threshold voltage. We have seen channel length is decreased, then threshold voltage decreases, but here if channel width is decreased, then increases threshold voltage. So this is the main effect, that if you are decreasing the width, and in the experiment we are also doing the same thing. You can check it by LTSpice 50 nanometer technology node we are using. So in that when you are increasing the, when you are comparing the channel length at a large channel length and low channel length, means a smaller channel length, then you can notice down that the threshold voltage is decreasing, but in case of width decrease, threshold voltage will be increasing. This you can notice down and observe. Gate induced drain leakage is also one term we are used frequently, gate induced drain leakage. So when gate voltage is zero, MOSFET should be off. When gate voltage is zero, then generally it should be off, and hence drain current must be zero. But even if VGS is zero, the large drain voltage there is leakage current. If VGS you are keeping zero, but VDS is not zero, VDS is large. In that case, VDS is much larger than zero. VDS is much larger than zero, though VGS is zero. In that case, this type of consideration is there. So these are the conditions. Even VGS is zero, but previously in long channel device we have considered that if VGS is zero, you can keep VDS any value, still there will be no current, it will be in cutoff region. But it is not true for short channel devices. It is not true, because even this VGS is zero, but you have applied VDS and it is large, much larger than zero, then there will be some leakage current. So it is called gate induced drain leakage, GIDL, this value. So for large drain voltage, there is a leakage current in the device due to band to band tunneling, and it is coming due to band to band tunneling here, and this leakage current is known as gate induced drain leakage. Clear? So drain induced barrier lowering was there, and GIDL, gate induced drain leakage, is also there. So these are the effects. Other small geometry effects we can see. There are several other effects like hot electron. Already explained hot electron effect. Hot electron means when you are applying high, means when you are lowering the dimension and you are applying even same voltage, the field is generated. The field generated inside the channel is more, and it creates hot electron. Means the electrons which are flowing in this condition, they are called hot electrons. Those electrons which are contributing to current in very high field, they are called hot electrons, and they will be affecting the situation. Already I have explained that it is affecting the performance. So as technology node advances, means dimensions are scaled, and a faster rate of because they are decreasing very faster rate with time. So as a result of field is basically field in channel is increased, and this increases the horizontal and vertical field. You are applying gate voltage, that is creating vertical field. You are applying drain voltage, that is creating horizontal field. So these electrons and holes are gaining very high energy, and therefore they are called hot electrons, and they are injected into the gate oxide. They can go into gate oxide and cause some permanent changes in the oxide charges distribution, and degrading the performance of high current. This is the situation. And time dependent breakdown, dielectric breakdown. This dielectric can be broken down also. If gate oxide thickness of the MOS device is very much thin, because it is shrinking. So for the lower advanced node or lower dimensions we are going, then it is shrinking aggressively in deep submicron devices. Therefore, this field EOX, which is basically means lateral field or horizontal field, VDD by TOX, vertical field it is, VDD, whatever supply voltage you are applying, divided by thickness. And thickness you are reducing, means this vertical field is increasing, and this puts excessive electrical stress on the ultra thin oxide. And at some field, at some level, when field is at the level of breaking it, so the oxide can be break down. So instead of oxide, it will not act as the oxide, and it dielectric breakdown can happen. So when this field is becoming larger, this oxide may be not behaving like oxide, and it is breaking down. So when thin oxide is operated at very high electric field over the period of time, for long time, then depending on the long, depending on the channel length and all the dimensions, if it is breaking down, then it's permanent damage. So dielectric breakdown will damage the device, and which is also called time dependent dielectric breakdown, and it will be completely means damaged device. If dielectric is broken down, it will not work as a MOSFET. Also, few important things are scaling. So let us see scaling. Generally, MOSFET dimensions are scaling from long channel to short channel you are going. So according to scaling Moore's law, this is Moore's law. It is very much important driving force for the scaling. Long back Intel Intel Moore's has predicted that during last century, around beginning of this era of the semiconductor, he has predicted that every 2 year or 1.5 year, the density of the devices should be doubled in the same chip. Means on the same chip, you have to double the number of transistors to be fabricated. So double either in 18 month or at least in 2 year, within 18 month or 2 year, it should be doubled. So same thing industry is following. And due to that, means you have to accommodate more devices, more transistor on the same area and same chip. You have to scale down the dimensions. So dimensions of the devices are scaled down. And according to technology roadmap of semiconductor, the shrinking factor is 0.7, which is 1 by root 2, around 0.7. And the scaling factor is around 1.4. And during the different years, 1997, 1999, up to 2012, we can see here three different technology nodes. Like channel length is minimum channel length is 350 nanometer, 250 nanometer, then 180, then 130, 90 nanometer, 65 nanometer, 45 nanometer, 32 nanometer, even now 14 nanometer and 7 nanometer also people are working. So this is the shrinking factor, 0.7, around 0.7 it is, and it is scaling factor is around 1.4. And then there may be two type of scaling, like constant field scaling. We can do constant field scaling. So constant field scaling is requiring that field should be constant. You are shrinking the dimension, then dimension should be shrinked in such a way that field should be constant. So you have to maintain constant field. So constant field scaling is basically a constant is that in constant field scaling dimensions of the MOSFET and the voltage also, they are scaled in such a way that field is constant. You can maintain constant field when suppose field is means lateral field you are considering. So VD drain voltage divided by length. So drain voltage divided by length, if you are scaling length, channel length is decreased and voltage you are not decreasing, then what will happen? More field will be created, but you want same field, so voltage should also be scaled. So this is the main condition. So in this case, generally what we see, what is the effect of this type of scaling? Scaling significantly affects the power dissipation and reduces the power dissipation by a factor of S square, where S square is the scaling factor. Sorry, S is scaling factor. So if in this case, you are maintaining the constant field and reducing the dimensions and also voltage, so it reduces the power dissipation by a factor of S square, where S is the scaling factor for the dimensions and voltage also. In this way, cost reduction, what is the cost of reduction for getting this reducing power? We are reducing the drain current. So at the cost of reduction of the drain current, we are getting this benefit. And here we can see full scaling of the, means by maintaining constant field, which is also called full scaling. What we are doing, channel length is initially support before scaling L, and after scaling it is L dash. So it is becoming L by L, S, whereas S is scaling factor. By S maybe sometimes 10 or any number, depending on that, everything will be scaled. So L dash is new channel length is L by S, new width will be also W by S, initial width was W, oxide thickness also scaled in similar fashion, that TOX dash equal to TOX by S. And junction depth is also scaled in the similar fashion. Whatever diffusion you are doing for drain and source, like here it is MOS and this is N plus source and this is N plus drain. This is oxide. Some overlap is there. After that, there is polysilicon or metal, which is acting as gate. Oxide we are making in this way. We are giving some. This is oxide, and this is P-type substrate. So you are doping and diffusing it up to which depth? You are diffusing it, whatever diffusion is done up to which depth, this is XJ, that is junction depth. Further, the source or drain. So diffusion, N plus diffusion is done at this much distance, this is XJ. So XJ is also important parameter. So here we can see XJ means junction depth is now XJ dash, which is XJ by S. And voltage also scaled, power supply voltage, which is VDD. The technology node is working on this much VDD power supply. It may be 1 volt, 5 volt, whatever. So initially it was suppose 5 volt working, but now at the after full scaling, means constant field scaling, VDD should also be scaled by the same factor. VDD dash is VDD by S. Also threshold voltage should be scaled. So VT dash, new threshold voltage is VT by S. Also, what is the doping concentration, Na and Nd? Na, in the P-type substrate here, Na, P-type substrate is requiring acceptor type doping. So here Na will be scaled, Na dash is equal to S into Na. Similarly, Nd dash will be scaled by, if you are making P-type transistor, here N channel transistor, it is NA is there, but if you are making some p-channel transistor where you will take starting substrate as N time, so ND dash, it is also scaled S into ND. So doping is done in this way. And what is the effect? So by this type of scaling, we are getting gate oxide. This is basically a new, if COX is the gate oxide for the lung channel, now new gate oxide is COX dash, which is just times COX. Whatever oxide gate oxide capacitance per unit area was COX initially, now it will become COX dash, which is just times COX. And drain current is basically ID dash is ID times ID divided by S times. And power is also divided P dash new power. Initially P power is P, new power is P dash, which is P by S square. P is power reduced by S square. Also power density. So power density is initially power by area. So basically here P dash by area dash. So which is equal. So almost P, this type of effects are there. So it is evident that effect of power dissipation, it reduces power dissipation by a factor of S square at the cost of reduction of drain current by a factor of S. So here we can see drain current is reduced by ID. It is now ID dash, which is ID by S. So power is less power we can get, but whatever dissipated power is basically less by factor of S square, but power density is not changing. Power density is same. Power density is same, but power dissipation, actual power dissipation, total power dissipation is reduced by a factor of S square. This is the constant field scaling. Other is constant voltage scaling. Constant voltage scaling is also very important. So sometimes means combination of both are used in different depending on requirement. So here what is the requirement? Constant voltage. Voltage must be same. You have to scale down the dimensions in such a way that applied voltage is same. So in constant voltage scaling, dimensions of the MOSFET are scaled, but terminal voltage are kept constant. And this type of scaling increases the electric field. Obviously, it will increase electric field. You are reducing the dimension, but keeping the same voltage applied. So this type of scaling is used when signal levels and IC cannot be scaled to match the signal requirements and the chip. Printed circuit board or on which various requirements are there, they are not able to match the signal level. Same signal level is required. You don't need to use any level shifter, because you are changing the signal level, then level shifter will be required, and somewhere if it is not able to cope up and level shifting other requirements is increasing. So instead of field increasing means constant field scaling, we use this voltage scaling. And in this case, just a summary is that what happens, L is scaled by a factor L dash, by a factor S, which is becoming now L dash is equal to L by S. W is also scaled by factor S, so W by S, new W, new oxide thickness TOX by S, new junction depth is XJ by S, and BDD is same. Here power supply, only power supply we are keeping constant. So new VDD dash is VDD. So voltage initially at long channel, whatever voltage was there, so means supply voltage was there, this time it is same. Other things are like previous case, but this one is the main changes. And this is why VT dash also we are keeping constant, and NA dash is S square times NA, and ND dash is S square times ND. The effect is that gate oxide capacitance is now COX dash, which is just times COX. Current is basically ID dash, which is ID times S dash. Here S is multiplying. So ID dash is now ID times S. And power density, total power dissipation P dash is P times S. So scaling factor is multiplied by power. Power is now is multiplied by scaling factor. And power density is basically P dash by area dash, which is S cube into actual power, previous power. So S cube times means the scaling factor cube times previous power density. So now power density is changed. So these are few things and few advantage we can discuss. So before scaling, we have something different length and different field and all. So if you are using means combination of the scaling, both the scaling can be combined together, or sometimes different scaling can be used. So more transistor can be integrated. The benefit is, what is the benefit we can get? more transistors can be integrated in the chip, means more capability and improvement in speed. Also, due to the decreased channel length and hence the decrease in transit time, this is why speed is improving, and increase in current. Also, improved parasitic capacitances, means whatever parasitic capacitances were there, that will be means improving, and throughput will be improving. Also, short channel effects, following are the disadvantages that we'll be facing. Short channel effects, complex process technology, parasitic effect dominates over transistor, and also lithography, means the MOSFET scaling is ultimately limited by the following processes, that lithography is different for the short channel devices. Different lithography is required, different quantum effects will be there, and tunneling, outside tunneling will be there. So these must be considered. Next, we can quickly come to understand the threshold voltage. Just quickly, I am explaining that here, this is the built-in, means this is PN junction, in which this is P-type, this is N-type, and here ions are there. In N side, positive ions, and N-P side, negative ions. Then built-in potential V naught is there. So built-in potential, how to calculate? It is basically KT by Q, ln Na, ND by Ni. And width is given by this equation, and no need of talking all. These will be used in during the calculation of threshold voltage and others we are requiring. Therefore, quickly just reminding. So I'm not talking too much. Therefore, and then capacitance, if you have to calculate this junction capacitance, Cj A by 2 Q epsilon V naught minus V ND Na by ND plus Na, where this Q charge is basically given by with the help of this capacitance A. Under 2 Q epsilon Na Nd by Na plus Nd V naught minus V. So these are quickly, and then this is now further we have to see also MOS capacitor. So MOS capacitor in the MOSFET, which we have taken to understand the this threshold voltage, we should understand the operation of this one. So this is the gate, this is the oxide, and this is the substrate. This is forming a MOS capacitor. And voltage which is applied this at this terminal is called gate terminal voltage VG. So this is metal, aluminium metal or polysilicon. Also in the MOSFET case, polysilicon may be there. So this is the three terminal device which is called MOS structure, metal oxide semiconductor capacitor. And in this basically, if it is forming, then there must be band means in if band diagram we see. So initially they have separate band diagram. This is Fermi level for the metal, and this is vacuum level, and this is oxide. Oxide has very high band gap, 8 electron volt, and between this means we can see so many terminology like work function Q phi m, means in terms of voltage, Q phi in terms of volt we are writing. Q is multiplied, then it is giving in volt. Otherwise, it is phi m is in electron volt. So Q phi m is the work function of the metal. Q phi s is the work function of the semiconductor. And energy required to take electron from Fermi level to free space, it is also defined as work function. And work function differences between the metal, which is a metal or aluminium, or it may be also polysilicon. This is also an important parameter. Then at equilibrium, what should be there? Fermi levels must be aligned. So here we can see, here you see, it is separately shown. It is for the P-type semiconductor. Here Fermi level is very close to valence band. And this is the, means due to the whatever doping is done, due to that, this is intrinsic Fermi level. And after that, it is becoming P-type, then Fermi level is not here. In intrinsic level, it is in between, means in between mid of the EC and EV, but it is going down and very close to the valence band, it is Fermi level is shown. And then these must be, and this is vacuum level basically. So these must be aligning. So MOS structure is basically formed, then this is the changes happens, that Fermi level of the metal and Fermi level of the this P-type semiconductor, they are getting aligned. And this Q phi s is the amount of the basically, this phi s is basically surface potential after an alignment if MOS structure is formed. So whatever surface potential is there, that is multiplied by Q, it is giving you voltage in terms of this potential. Surface potential is given in terms of voltage, volt. And this is intrinsic level, this is again Fermi level for P-type material, this is valence band, this is conduction band. So this is the bending, band is bending. for the whatever mass, if this p type substrate you are taking, and then oxide, then metal, then this type of bending is happening, and this phi f is Fermi potential, which is difference between the Fermi EF and this intrinsic level of the bulk material. And phi s is surface potential, though we are not going in much detail. So q phi m minus q phi s, it is basically amount of bending is required, whatever bending, how much bending will be there in the bands, it will be decided by work function of the metal and work function of the semiconductor. So q phi m minus q phi s will decide how much bending is going on, and depending on that, it can be having some definition of flat band voltage. So built-in potential, basically potential or work function differences is called flat band voltage. Metal work function divided minus semiconductor work function, it is called it is called flat band voltage, because Fermi level is getting aligned, and this flat band voltage is decided by what is the work function of the metal minus what is the work function of the semiconductor. So this work function of metal may be aluminum work function or any other metal work function, or if you are making with polysilicon metal, gate metal is polysilicon, then here means per, this one work function of polysilicon will be taken. So phi m minus phi s, this will decide the work function, and it can be operated in different regions. It basically mass capacitor operates if we can keep Vg less than 0, or it can be Vg can be greater than 0 but it's small, less than Vt, and also it can be Vg can be greater than Vt. So this is why accumulation, depletion and inversion regions are there for this operation, that we can quickly understand that if it is in the inversion region, sorry, if it is in cutoff region, or we can say accumulation region, so what happens? Vg is less than 0 and so many holes are accumulated underneath the oxide, and this is the band, this is the band diagram, Fermi level of the metal, and this is bending downside, Fermi level is bending downside, this conduction band is bending downside, this EI level, and this is the alignment. We can see whatever alignment was previously there, if they are making a junction, then they were aligned here, Fermi level E F for metal, EFM, and EFP for the p-type semiconductor, but it is here bending. So by application of this negative voltage, some bending, this type of downside bending is there, and this is QVG. It is means differences we can see between this metal level, Fermi level, and Fermi level of the p-type semiconductor. It is equal to Q times gate voltage, whatever gate voltage you are applying. So similarly in depletion region also, alignment will be there, but it is now up, means in different direction, because you are applying positive voltage. Previously, if you are applying negative voltage, then the positive charges are on the negative charges are on the gate. Therefore, they are attracting holes. So all holes are accumulated underneath the oxide. This is oxide. This is the gate, and this is the p-type substrate. So many holes are accumulated, and this region is accumulation region, and this is the band diagram of the this region. And if in depletion region, just opposite, gate voltage is positive, though it is not strong enough, means gate voltage is not high enough to make a strong inversion, but depletion region can be created, because this positive gate voltage will create positive charges on this plate. This will repel the holes, so many holes are suppressed downside here, here some depletion region will be created, and this field which is coming into picture due to this positive gate voltage, it is now creating depletion region here. So gate voltage positive are applied, which is repelling the holes, and they are going down, and this is the depletion region created. And if depletion region is created, then it means that no free charge carriers are present here, but there may be some immobile charge carriers, that is means ions may be there. So as in PN junction we have seen in the N side, means positive ions are there, and P side negative ions are there in PN junction. So means those ions cannot be avoided, but free charge carriers will be not present, and this is the depletion region. So depletion region depends on the junction between the different semiconductor P and N type, that we will discuss depending on the operation. So this is the depletion region which is created. Now still electrons may be, if you short channel device, then some electrons may be coming at even small gate voltage, which is less than VT but positive. But in long channel devices, almost we are considering the treatment that here no any magnetic charge carriage accumulated, and it is free of charge carriage. Neither holes are there, not electrons are there, so no any pre-charge carrier, and it is only having some immobile ionic charges. And the depletion region is created, and this is the band diagram EC and EI, and Fermi level of the p-type material and Fermi level of the metal. So now it is almost aligned, we can see. And this is QVG, whatever gate voltage you are applied. Then this charge which is there inside the depletion region, that can be calculated, because p-type acceptor type you are taking the substrate. So DQ is, can be calculated, minus Q and A. Q is the electronic charge, and A is the NA is the acceptor type doping, which is done in the p-type material, and with this strip you are doing for a small dx element. And this is the depth of the means depletion region thickness. So basically completely you are not doing for a small strip, you are defining dq. After that, by solving Poisson's equation, as we have already derived during the derivation completely, so from that we are able to find out that d phi equal to minus x d phi by dq by epsilon si, and then readjust, and then finally integrate from phi f to phi s, integrate from 0 to xd, and then we are able to find out xd and finally q. So I am not going in that detail, that that was already done, but here again repeating the things to solve the problems. So this depletion region charge is given by this equation, that minus 2q na epsilon si phi s minus phi f. All these terminologies already defined. So in the case of inversion, strong inversion, we have to apply much higher voltage VG, which is greater than threshold voltage. Now we can see so many electrons are accumulated, and this is the situation. Now means this is the Fermi level of the p side, this is valence band, this is conduction band, and this is Fermi level in the metal. So QVG, Fermi level in the metal, this one, and now it is up. Previously less voltage was there. You have to invert it. 1 minute. Here inversion is not taking place, but here you have to invert it. So it is Fermi level of metal is here, but here Fermi level of the p-type metal is still gone too much up, and it is totally inverted. So inversion is basically done. Inversion means you are inverting. Whatever inversion is doing, the surface potential should be minus Q times phi f. So you are inverting the surface potential, and Q phi f is defined as EF minus EI in this I level. So basically the definition of inversion is that at a point at which density of electrons on the surface is equal to the density of holes on the bulk, on the actual p-type substrate which you have taken, whatever density of the holes was there, exactly same amount of electrons may be, means similar density of electrons may be present in channel, then we tell that it is strong inversion. Inversion, or we say strong inversion. So according to the definition of strong inversion or actual inversion definition, that we must create a number of electrons exactly similar density of electrons in the channel, then it is called inversion. And in that case, the surface potential of that region will be reversed. So means opposite of that of the bulk. So this is totally taken into account, and based on that we are defining threshold voltage. So threshold voltage is the voltage required to create the inversion. Voltage between gate and source which is applied to create the inversion, it is called threshold voltage. So if we understand now threshold voltage, what is threshold voltage? VT0, and VT0 we are defining. VT0 means no body voltage is applied. At body no voltage is applied, then it is defined as threshold voltage VT0, or zero body mass threshold voltage. And basically when VGS was less than VT, then transistor was off, and VGS is equal to or even greater than VT, then at VT0 it is starting on, getting on, and then after that VT0 is more than VGS is more than VT0, then it is a strong inversion is there, and high current is possible. So work function for doing this inversion, or for making the sufficient current possible, too many components are there. Work function differences between the gate and channel, which is also called flat band voltage, and gate voltage which is required to change the surface potential means opposite means whatever surface potential for p type semiconductor was there, that should be just opposite for the n type. To create that opposite surface potential, some voltage is required, and gate voltage to offset the depletion charges. In depletion region, whatever charges are to means offset them, some voltage is required. Also, gate voltage to offset the fixed charges on the oxide and semiconductor interface. So, to calculate this flat band voltage, we have to consider these four type of terms. So, therefore, first term phi GC is taken. Phi GC means phi this part work function difference. Work function difference, or it is also sometimes called flat band voltage. So this is phi GC. Also after that inversion, you are doing inversion, so minus 2 phi F, and then other term is to deplete the means to offset the this depletion region charges. So in that case, what is the situation? Phi S is equal to opposite of phi F. In that case, charge already we know that this is the charge, and therefore the in this equation this modification can be done. Phi S equal to minus phi F. So surface potential is now becoming minus phi F. So here we are getting minus 2 phi F. So new equation is now QB0, which is basically you are trying to offset the depletion region charges. Then this much QB0 will be present. So QB0, Q was defined in this way, 2Q Na epsilon Si phi S minus phi F. But in this case, in strong inversion condition, phi S equal to minus phi F. Therefore, this is replaced by phi F, and then this this is defined at QB0. Why QB0? We are defining means zero substrate bias. In zero substrate bias, the charge is equal to QB0, which is equal to 2Q minus 2Q Na epsilon Si minus 2 phi F. But in the case of non-zero bias substrate, if substrate bias is non-zero, BSV is non-zero, then here an additional term will be added, that is plus BSV also. So here one additional term will be added, that is BSV also. So this QB0 is the charge in the case where body bias is zero, and QB is the charge in the case when body bias is there, that is BSV. So due to larger depletion region, these are the charges which we have calculated. After that, we can put also these terms. COX, we are defining that is epsilon OX by TOX, which is capacitance per unit area. Then VT0 is now without any body bias, phi GC minus 2 phi F minus QB plus COX. And any other additional term, if it is required, that is basically we should also offset the which charges at the interface. So that also we can include. So that is here again included additional term, that QOX also. So we are considering the means here we have shown dot dot dot. So additional term which we should consider, that is correction should be done for non-ideal fixed charges on the interface. Fixed positive charges QOX at the boundary between the gate oxide and substrate, there are some charges that should be considered. Due to that, some voltage will be offset voltage will be required. So minus QOX by COX. So in this way, this is the equation. This is the equation of threshold voltage Q means phi GC means between gate and channel, whatever means due to metal work function differences, and this minus 2 phi F minus QB0 by COX minus QOX by COX when VSB is 0. So when VSB is 0, substrate bar between substrate and body, when voltage is 0, then this is the equation. So if substrate body consideration we are doing, so this can be adjusted. This is the equation you have found, but it can be adjusted in such a way that here we are defining VT0 at zero bias, whatever zero body bias, threshold voltage is defined as VT0. So VT is defined as VT0 minus QB by QB minus QB0, and which is also in terms of we have already derived this, but we are discussing directly. So VT equal to VT0 plus gamma under root minus 2 phi F plus VSB, and VSB was 0 initially if phi SB is voltage at body is 0, and minus 2 under root 2 phi F. So BSB may be 0 or it may not be 0. This is generalized equation. It is valid. If BSB is 0, then we can this is generalized equation which is valid for all the cases. It is VSB is 0, then only VT0 will be there. and VSB is present, then this complete equation will be there. And where gamma is body effect coefficient, means substrate bias coefficient, if body effect is present, this is the coefficient to modify, and this is given by root 2 q n a epsilon psi by cox. So these equations I have not derived, not given too much time, but it was derived previously. So this will be used to calculate with different problems. So in this case, quickly we can summarize. VSB is zero, then this is the substrate, this is the threshold voltage equation. And if VSB is not zero, then this is the this is the threshold voltage equation, where VT zero is the equation for the threshold voltage, which is zero bias, zero body bias threshold voltage. VT zero is defined at zero body bias threshold voltage, and gamma factor already defined. So these are two conditions, and this is complete derivation. Also, 1 minute. Time is over. Okay, just quickly 1 minute. Phi f is less than zero. Whatever phi f we have defined for n mass, it is less than zero. For this p mass, it is greater than. We have taken phi f negative. We can see, and here in the p mass it is positive. Qb is less than negative. Qb is negative, but in case of p mass it is positive. Gamma is more than zero for the n mass. Gamma is less than zero for p mass. VSB should be between substrate and body positive voltage. Means body should be negative and substrate should be positive with respect to body, then it is positive, and in this case VSB is less than zero. Then what is the effect of body voltage? We can see here threshold voltage is basically defined in y-axis, and the substrate bias is defined here. So we can see if you are increasing VSB, this is substrate voltage is increasing. So quickly we can stop here because so many things were there. After that, one more thing was there, that threshold voltage adjustment. So by VT can be increased by adding acceptors type, more acceptors in p-type substrate. You are doping more p-type material, then threshold voltage will be increasing. Also VT can be decreased by adding donors, n-type material, n-type donors you are adding, then it can be decreased. You are adding more acceptors, then it can be increased. This is the method by which threshold voltage can be adjusted. So generally, this is the change of threshold voltage is defined as delta VT0 equal to QNI by COX, where density of implanted ions NI. NI, it may be any type, either you can implant N type or P type, whatever. So it is approximate value. Now I can, I have planned some questions, that threshold voltage calculations, but you are going for new class. Actually, this problem you can solve. Previously also I have given this material, this problem in the beginning, that calculate threshold voltage for the polysilicon gate NMOS transistors with the following parameters. Na is given, TOX is given, ND is given, NOX is given. Oxide.
HP, so.
Okay, stopping.
So my next class is about to start, sir.
Yes. So this is means you can quickly see in the initial threshold voltage derivation we have discussed this, given this one, you can try. We will see it later on. Okay, skip. Ending up 1 minute. Sorry for delay. I should manage it quickly, but 1 minute. Many people left class. Okay, stop. Now, okay, you can go to other class.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.